All right, I wanted to go over the mean variance portfolio optimization again because I felt like the last time I did it didn't really make much sense. So let's go through it again. Mean variance is a form of portfolio optimization that you can use on your investment stocks. And the idea is that for the more risk you take on, the more reward you should earn from that risk. However, you don't want to take on a point where it's no longer efficient with what the market is doing. So this is a way to calculate the most efficient portfolio allocation for highest returns as well as the lowest risk, and you can choose where on that frontier, efficient frontier, you want to place your allocations on. So it'll make more sense when we jump into it. So we're going to install YFinance to get the data. And then we're going to import the usual suspects here, YFinance, Pandas, NumPy, Matplotlib, and Seaborn. And here we can set the number of symbols that we want to use. I grabbed a bunch here, everything from Apple, Microsoft, Meta, Amazon, ExxonMobil, it's Disney, Coca-Cola, Caterpillar, Ford, Hershey's. So I got a lot of different symbols here across different industries, and hopefully to get a good mix of what sort of stocks I should weight these on to get the best portfolio. We're going to download the data passing through our symbols. We're going to take from 2018 to late February 2023, and this is what we get in return. So here, the main idea is to visualize the cumulative returns of each stock in the portfolio. We're just going to look at the adjusted close price. And it looks like a jumbled mess, but each line represents part of the returns of the stock, right? And you can sort of see this dip here. And if you have any idea of what this happened during that time, it should be pretty obvious. So we need something to benchmark our portfolio returns by, and I just chose the S&P 500. And in my research preparing for this video, they suggested that you should create a correlation heat map to visualize the portfolio asset neutrality. In other words, you just want to select a diverse type of stocks, focused on different industries. And that sort of intuitively makes sense. You'll see, for example, if we take Microsoft and Apple here, you see that it has a very almost It's almost white, right? Which means that it has a very high correlation, and that makes total sense. They're direct competitors of one another. It's just a good way to visualize the stocks that you've picked and whether or not you've picked a basket of stocks that are highly correlated to one another, or if you have a good mix. And I think based on what I'm seeing here, there's enough here to show that some of them are, really correlated, and some of them aren't. That's exactly what we want. So the next step would be to optimize. We're going to use this Pi portfolio opt package that I found to help us with the calculating the efficient frontier and the mean variance. So we're going to split our data into train and test, and then we need to get our sigma and mu, and that's just calculated using the expected returns of the exponential moving average historical return on our train. The same goes for our risk models, exponential covariant on our train as well. And to show you what that looks like, what you want to do here is find which return has the highest. So in this instance, it's Ford with 0.84 because we're going to we need to visualize the efficient frontier somehow. So we want to visualize it in a span between zero and our highest return here, taking 0.01 steps in between that range. And then we're going to essentially go through each step in here, right? Calculate the efficient frontier, get the efficient return for each step, and then append the portfolio performance into our volume efficiency here, or volatility. I'm blanking on what exactly vol EF was supposed to stand for. But then we can actually calculate the portfolio performance both on the minimum volatility as well as the minimum volatility return. And then we can do the same for the Sharpe. So we want to maximize the Sharpe ratio and maximize the Sharpe volatility. All right, so then now we can visualize that graph. We're going to create four different elements to this graph. We want to calculate a line to signal our efficient frontier, and we've calculated that above. The scatter plot is going to represent our portfolio with the minimum variance, and then we're going to have another plot data point that signifies our maximum Sharpe portfolio. And then we also want the market capital line. So when we run this, we'll get this kind of graph. And I'm going to zoom out just a tad bit so you guys can see what I'm looking at here a little bit better. So you can see here's the red line is the capital market line. The blue line is the efficient return. The green, where they intersect on the market capital and the efficient frontier, is the maximum amount of volatility to the average return that's most efficient. The more we continue to go along this efficient frontier, the farther away we get from our capital market line, meaning that it's less efficient. So we could be getting more returns for taking on more volatility, but it's not as the returns that we're getting aren't as efficient for that volatility that we take on or that risk that we take on, and vice versa. So let's say we have our, you know, minimum volatility down here. It's pretty far from our average returns market, our capital market line. And it just shows that it's efficient given the volatility that we take. Hopefully this makes sense. The graph, I think, really helps conceptually understand what it is that we're trying to do here. Essentially, we're just trying to pick a portfolio that stays on this efficient frontier so that no matter how much volatility that we're taking on, algorithmically, we should be getting average returns that are efficient to the market capital for those stocks that we've chosen. So let me zoom back in. So we want to get our weights for the minimum variance to see how we should be weighting our portfolio. And in this case, the top three stocks that we want to buy into the most is Johnson & Johnson, Amazon, and Hershey's. Interestingly enough, the calculations here don't suggest buying Apple, don't suggest buying Meta or Microsoft to keep our variance low, right? Let's look at the maximum Sharpe in this instance. If we wanted to maximize our Sharpe ratio for our average returns, maximum average returns here, we would pick Caterpillar, UPS, and Meta as our top three stocks. But we would also take on a lot more volatility, an annual volatility of 19% versus an annual volatility of 13%. But we're also getting much more rewards, right? 59% expected annual return versus 25%. Right, and you can also see here our Sharpe ratio. Our maximum Sharpe is 3 versus our Sharpe ratio of 1.7. And for context, a Sharpe ratio of 3 is considered very good. We also want to backtest this portfolio to see if, you know, if we put into production our min variance portfolio as well as our maximum sharp portfolio, how it would compare against just buying into maybe like SPY or something along those lines. So this is where our S&P 500 index comes into play. And so let's backtest it. So the cumulative returns here for minimum variance would be the blue line. Maximum sharp is the red line. Adjusted close is the green line. The adjusted close is just the S&P 500 returns. So in this instance, when we backtest our model, we actually find that the minimum variance outperformed our maximum sharp, which is sort of interesting because it's under the assumption that we wouldn't be getting the same kind of returns that we would have with our maximum sharp, right? So that's the importance of backtesting. And the backtesting, I'll admit, is, you know, is pretty straightforward. There's probably a lot more that I could do here to optimize. But the point of the video is to give you guys a good understanding of what it is that mean variance can do for your portfolio. I think this code would give you a pretty decent idea for how to set up your own mean variance on your own portfolio. So I hope you found it valuable, and let me know in the comments. It really helps me understand what kind of videos I should be making next and what I can do differently to help you guys learn the concepts. So I will see you in the next one. Bye.